Hello, welcome to the training webinar for today. I'm Dale Franks. Today's webinar is once again one that was suggested by Dan Kruger from, oh my goodness, Dan, I don't remember your university's name right off the top of my head. I apologize. But anyway, this is a customer-suggested webinar topic, and today we're going to talk about all of the custom tasks. A couple of warnings before we begin. You will undoubtedly see custom tasks on my system that you do not have. Also, I have a problem, which is a dog. You will not be able to chew this. I am sorry. He bought a horn in and wants to chew it in the office. And that we can't allow, because all we will hear is clattering and bumping as he chews his buffalo horn. So we're going to move him out of here so that he doesn't do that. In any event, as I was saying, there are going to be some custom tasks that I have that you don't have. I have a whole universe of custom tasks, some of which are very specific. As we look at them and we see them, I'll point those out to you. If you don't have them, don't worry about it. You probably wouldn't be able to use them anyway, or they're outdated. So just keep that in mind. I have a little bit of a different setup on my system than you have, because my system is a development system. It's going to take a while to go through all these. I'm pretty sure I'm going to take the entire 2 hours because there are a lot of custom tasks. So thank you, Dan, for suggesting this. By the way, I should say that this has required more preparation time from me than almost any other one that I've done. UW Stout in Menominee, Wisconsin is where Dan Kruger is from. So Dan, thank you very much for making this suggestion. As I said, it took a long time to do this. I had to not only document what all of these are and put them into notes so that I could present them in some sort of logical fashion, but also I had to start and look at the configuration screen for every single one of these so that we didn't have to wait 10 seconds, 15 seconds for each of these forms to just-in-time compile on my system so that it wouldn't take up extra time in the webinar. So I put a lot of effort into this. Whether the result will be worth the effort, we are about to find out. So I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. And we will start off with the custom tasks. Now, I'm just going to pull them straight off of my system here. And we're just going to go through them folder by folder and do them all in order, because I think that's the easiest way of doing that. Now, there are several things that you may see in some of these folders that are either custom scripts, or in this case, it is a drop-down object. So there are a couple of things I'm going to skip, but I am going to talk about all of the custom tasks themselves. And we are going to start off with fill fields from Active Directory. What this enables you to do is to, and by the way, we're going to be pretty short on most of these because we have a lot of time to go through. So we're going to look at them briefly, and I'm going to explain in cases where it's necessary where you would use these, but we're not going to get into any details. We simply don't have the time to do so. So this custom task enables you to fill fields on a form from your Active Directory installation. So you can actually query Active Directory, pull data back, and place the form fields into a form. I know that people do this, but I'm not entirely sure why, but you have the ability to actually do that, to pull this data out of Active Directory and pull it into a form, and you can map each of the attributes in a user's Active Directory account to a form field on the form. So you can pull all the standard as well as all of the custom fields from Active Directory and put them into a form. The rule query from Active Directory also allows you to query Active Directory and to return back some AD properties from your Active Directory accounts. However, it actually returns the results to a business rule. Now, we have a type of business rule, which is the rule query. And so you can actually use one of these custom tasks. And there are a couple of rule query custom tasks. You can actually use them in conjunction with the business rule to return the value from the custom task as a business rule value. So you can link up, in this case, your business rule with some Active Directory information. This does get a little bit tricky in terms of what you want to pull back, because obviously if you have 30,000 users in Active Directory, you're gonna want to implement some custom filters probably to return a smaller group of records, perhaps even a single record, in order to return a value from a business rule, because returning 30,000 values from a business rule would be a little inconvenient. So it does require some knowledge of Active Directory, some knowledge of being able to specify custom filters, which, by the way, so does the fill fields from Active Directory custom task. You are going to want to filter your AD so that you're not pulling back your entire organization via Active Directory when you run those custom tasks. But those are the two Active Directory custom tasks. Similarly, there are only two case custom tasks in the system. The first is the copy case custom task. All this does is take case items, and it could be the forms, it could be the documents that are associated with the process, it could be the forms. You could do everything, or you could only pull back items from a specific group. And what this will allow you to do is copy all of these case instance objects from one case and create a new case instance that contains all of these objects that you have copied. So that's what the copy case custom task does. The set case property custom task usually only runs in the context of a running case instance itself. And what it enables you to do is select some case properties and set the values of those case properties. You can manually set the values. You can, using a container form of some kind, so if you run it out of a form, or if you run it off of a process timeline and you set the appropriate form as a container form, you can use form fields as the values to use to set the case properties. And of course, as I said, you can set them manually. You can also pull business values back and set them as well. So pretty useful. Although this is probably a fallback method. In most cases, if you are going to set case properties from a form, it's more efficient to associate the specific form field in the form definition itself with the case property rather than do it this way. However, you know, there are times when you, I think probably the most common use of this would be to manually set the case values or to set the case property values from a business value. Usually, if you're going to set them from a form field, just associate the form field with the case property, and the form field value will just automatically get saved with the case instance, and you won't need to use this particular custom task at all. Content actions. First one is the attach document. Now, I have a webinar where I discuss this in detail, and we go through how you use the attach document. But what it allows you to do is to either grab a document via a content picker, so you can just do it on the fly by grabbing a document, or just hard coding the content list path in, and it will pull a document out of the content list and will automatically attach it to a form. So you can have it preset to some document so it always attaches the same document, or you can have a content picker if you have a content picker on the form, and you can allow users to navigate through the content list. probably not something you would do very often, because it would require that you have content list permissions set appropriately so that the end users could actually see the content list folders that contained your documents. So there is some setup in terms of using a content picker, but in the example that I have in the webinar on this particular custom task, we actually just hard code using a content list path. We just hard code where the file is located. And I actually have a couple of different activities with some needed when conditions. And based on what it is that I need, the appropriate activity will run. The activity will run this custom task and will choose a different document out of the content list. That's probably the most common way of using this. Rather than allowing the users to pick the file via a content picker, just to hard code the path and just have a one or more custom task activities that have needed when conditions, so that depending on what conditions apply, it only pulls the document or documents that are relevant to that particular, say, activity that you're running or process that you're running. You may have different process types, different request types, whatever it may be, and each one may need different types of documents. And so that's probably the best way of doing it, so that you don't actually have to give users access to any portion of your content list. Although you can set up your content list, create a folder that stores all of the documents, and just give end users access to that folder via permissions, so that when they use the content picker, the only folder they'll see are the folders that they have permissions to access, which in this case would probably be a single folder that would contain all of the relevant documents. So there's a couple of different ways to skin that cat. The create QR code, and by the way, we are looking at this in the content list directly. We're just previewing the custom config screen. Just warning you straight up, not all of these are going to work, and some of these are going to pop up with awful looking errors because we are running them directly from the preview mode in the content list. And so we can't actually configure from here. This is just the easiest way of showing all of these configuration screens to you, because if I tried to create a timeline or a form, well, there's a lot of complications. Some custom tasks only run in a timeline. Some only run in a form. I'd have to be switching back, and I'd constantly have to be, you know, adding custom tasks to the form so that we could look at it. And it would just get a little unwieldy and hard to do in order. So we're going to do it like this. Just keep in mind, we are looking at the preview custom configuration from the content list directly. So occasionally some of these are going to be a little wonky. The create QR code, basically, if you have a BP Logix image control, not the image control on the very top row of the online form designer, which ships with CK Editor, but the actual BP Logix image control, you can actually create a QR code and display it in that BP Logix image control on a form. So for QR code fans, that one's for you. The email import. This allows you to grab an email message, parse the text of that email message, and map it to a field on a form. You can also move email attachments to the process to show up as process attachments. You have some specific keywords that you might use in the email body. You can use those keywords to search through the email and find the actual text values that are associated with those keywords. You can use regular expressions to parse the text. And you can also look at the email headers and pull back data from specific email headers that are in the form. So you actually have a lot of different options for importing that data from the email. Most of the time you use this as part of offline completion via email, so that users can just reply to an email with, you know, approve or whatever, and you need to import those emails into the appropriate task. When you have it set up that way, and by the way, I have an entire webinar on how to do email imports, the email itself should actually have a TLID that's part of the email body. Process Director will actually find that TLID, will parse it, and will import the email into the appropriate process instance, and then it can be used to be parsed to complete an activity via parsing the text of the email itself. Again, I have an entire webinar on that. There is an old custom task called export items. Don't recommend that you use it. It has largely been deprecated by the export files to file system custom task. Some of you will still have this on your system. Perhaps most of you, it still remains in the product for backwards compatibility. So this is the version that we don't want you to use. It is simply called export items. We have not updated this custom task since May 29th of 2018, because it has been superseded by export files to file system. Both of them essentially do the same thing. So let's look at the one that we actually want you to use in the modern world, which is export files to file system. What it enables you to do is to take objects that are inside Process Director and export them to a local file system so that you can save them as files in an accessible file system, or you can also send them off to an SFTP server. And then your SFTP server will presumably stick them in the appropriate place as well. So you can do either or with the export files to file system. Export items did not have the SFTP capability, and so we created this back in 2022 to add that so that you could use either a file system or SFTP. Now, if you are using a file system, remember there is the allowed export locations custom variable. And that is a security implementation that you have to actually fill out in your custom variables file to specify the file system folders to which users can export objects. And if you pick a non-allowed export location, the export will not occur. So the nice thing about that is if you pick a parent folder, then you can create subfolders for that parent folder on the fly using export files to file system, and that's fine. So generally what people do is they will pick one or two parent folders on their file system, and then we'll just allow people to create the exports and throw them into some subfolder of that file system. However you want to arrange that is up to you, but you need to remember that the allowed export locations custom variable is going to prevent you from exporting to any location that you have not specified with that allowed export locations custom variable. That custom variable is basically a list so that you can have multiple allowed export locations. So you can have as many of them as you want, but Process Director will always ensure that it looks for that allowed export location before it actually allows you to save anything to the file system. So export files to file system, that's the one we want you to use. Export items, that's the old one. Obviously, if you're still using it on your system and have used it in the past, you can't get rid of it. It's got to stay there forever unless you go back and find all of the instances where this export item is used and replace it with export files to file system, which you clearly could do, but it's still in the product because we still have people who used it up to 2018. And quite frankly, even after 2018, some people used it. Just as you can export, you can import files from the file system or from an SFTP server as well. both import files from file system and export files from file system. Basically do the exact opposite things. One, I stick folders in the file system or stick documents in the file system. The other, I pull documents out of the file system. So you can just pull all the files out. You can pull up, you know, everything in an entire folder. You can specify some filters if you want. I think on the advanced tab, there are some filters there that you can supply, like maximum file sizes or the maximum number of files to import. So if you're, you know, pulling from a folder, you know, maybe you only want to pull the small files or whatever. And then there are other filters that you can apply, date filters and whatnot, that allow you to specify those objects that you want to pull from a particular file system. So useful if you're doing stuff like that. Item actions. This is obviously one of the more useful custom tasks that exist in the system. Let me check, by the way. I see that there is a question. I don't want to get... all right. Can you give an example of where one would need to use the fill fields from Active Directory? No, I can't. I don't work much with Active Directory. I don't know much about it. I do know that it's in the product because someone wanted to see it. Now, if you're an administrator, for troubleshooting, you may very well want to just be able to grab some items out of Active Directory and just look at them to get an idea of how they would import. I can't think of any non-administrative use for that in terms of something that you would show end users. Why you would need to show end user stuff out of your Active Directory is, yeah, a little unusual to me. It is possible, first of all, that I want to see stuff from Active Directory, so it's just easier to pop open a form, put in some filters, and just pull just that data directly out of Active Directory. It is also possible with one of the user custom tasks, like not provision users, but I forget which one. There's only two custom user tasks, and it's not provision users. But it's the one that allows you to update user accounts. You might actually be able to pull stuff from Active Directory, look at it, maybe make some changes to it, and then run the custom task to update that user account. Not sure why you would do that, because it seems that would get overwritten by Active Directory the next time that you did an AD sync. However, some organizations don't actually do an AD sync. Several organizations actually do their user imports via an Excel spreadsheet. So even though they have Active Directory, they're actually pulling their users via Excel and importing them via Excel, often for new users, not to update existing users. And so, you know, it might be a case where you wanted to pull that information, make changes to it, and update a user that was previously imported from Active Directory, but where those users have changed. But again, that would be purely an administrative thing that you would do. I just can't imagine why you would use one of the Active Directory custom tasks to show anything to end users. In fact, I can think of many, many, many reasons why you would, in fact, not want to do that. So back to item actions configuration. This allows you to take some objects that are somewhere in your process timeline, documents, forms, everything, and you can move them, you can copy them, you can save them into the content list, you can delete them, you can reset the permissions on them. Just gives you a lot of different options for modifying or saving or copying any item that exists inside a workflow. So you might want to copy a document from the process instance into a content list folder and store it permanently in the content list. And of course, you also can set permissions on an object using item actions. So it's very useful for manipulating items. Run report is pretty simple. All of it does is enables you to run a report object in the background. And once it's run, you can actually output it to several formats: PDF, JPEG, Word document, Excel, PowerPoint, CSV. So rather than finding a report, opening it, and going through all the pain of waiting for the report to open and generate, because some reports might be complex, it might take a long time to run, then the report is open. And once it's open, you can finally go and export the report manually. This allows you just to take that report and do that report compilation, display, and export all in the background, so that you're not forcing either your users to do that manually. You can just run, generate that report, and save it to the content list automatically. So it's pretty useful for being able to do that and doing that without having to manually do it. The database connector's custom tasks get a little complex. As a general rule, you no longer need to use any of these custom tasks. Well, that's not true. There's one that you absolutely positively need to use and should only use. Most of these are no longer necessary. And the reason they're no longer necessary is because business values exist. So we can grab that external data and virtualize it so it's available anytime we need it. The set form data tab on the form now exists, and we can use set form data to grab the data from a business value and automatically fill it in from the form. The fill dropdowns tab on a form definition exists, so I can automatically fill a dropdown from a business value. These are older custom tasks that existed prior to business values. Business values made a lot of this just go away in terms of necessity. Now, there may be some times when you actually do want to run one of these custom tasks because, let's say, the data is too sensitive to just run from a business value, because the plus and also possible downside of a business value is that the data is virtualized, which is to say it is now universally accessible by any implementer anywhere. They don't care where the data comes from or how they use it. They just know that if they grab a business value and they put a business value property in a form field, it's going to display the data. And most of the time, that's great. However, there may be some times when the data is a little more sensitive and you don't want to create a business value that just gives direct access to that data to, you know, anybody. You may want to be a little more circumspect about that. And so whenever you need to grab a piece of that sensitive data, you may want to use one of the database connector custom tasks just to pull that particular piece of data from a sensitive database that you don't want to give generalized access to via business value. The downside to the custom tasks is that if I want to look at the same data 10 times on 10 different forms, I have to create 10 different editions of this custom task, and I have to configure them all from scratch. That's super inconvenient and takes a lot of time. Business values liberate you from that necessity because the data is just simply always there, and their business values are all reusable. None of these custom tasks are reusable. So every time you use them, you have to configure them from scratch. So that makes them mildly inconvenient, which is why business values exist, so that we don't have to go through all of this anymore. Now, there is one of these, the very last one, SQL command, that has not been deprecated by anything, and we'll talk about that in a few minutes. So the advanced fill dropdown from DB basically goes out, allows you to write a SQL query that goes and pulls data from a database, returns that data to Process Director. You can then map the fields that you return from that SQL statement, you know, they come back as a record set, obviously, and then you can just map whatever columns return from that record set into a form field. Now, you got to be careful with this. Your queries have to be, in this case, they don't have to be, but for the advanced fill fields, there's something you have to think about in mind. We'll talk about that with advanced fill fields. I'm getting ahead of myself. This is field dropdown. You actually do want multiple field values to come back because you want to fill an entire dropdown with options. So in this case, it's not as important. You just go out, you grab all the rows of data that you want, and you stick them in a dropdown. And you can also specify, if you have multiple columns, you can specify which column is the ID column and which column is the display text column. So that's the advanced field dropdowns. There's the advanced field dropdown object. Now, advanced field dropdown fills a dropdown control on a form. The advanced field dropdown object actually fills a dropdown content list object from a database. So you can actually run this, fill a content list object from the database, and then if you have a dropdown on the form, it might be associated with that dropdown content list object. And when you run this custom task, it'll just reset the dropdown content list object, which obviously will automatically change all of the options available in the dropdown itself. So very useful custom task for filling out a dropdown object. And this is the tricky one, advanced fill fields from DB. You do want to be really careful about your filters for this custom task. And the reason is you want to fill a form field with the value from a single row. This custom task will error out if your SQL statement returns more than one row of data. So you have to ensure that your SQL command, whatever it is, just returns only the data that you want to fill that specific field or fields from the same row of data. But you generally only want to return one row of data from this custom task. Again, it allows you just to write whatever SQL statement that you want to write, pull the data back, and then you can map the data to a specific form fields. Again, assuming that we are only going to pull back one row of data. Now, these are the advanced versions of these custom tasks. There are non-advanced versions. We'll talk about the intervening ones here in a second. There is fill dropdown from DB, fill dropdown object from, well, we don't want to get to that one. There's fill dropdown object from DB and fill fields from DB. Now, the difference in the fill dropdown object as opposed to the advanced fill dropdown object is that we aren't expecting you to write SQL statements, not complete ones anyway. You may need to drop a where clause inside your configuration here. But in general, what we do is we just connect to a data source, connect to a table, and especially for fill dropdown, we probably aren't all that interested in having a where filter. I mean, we might be, but in general, we just grab the text and the value fields out of the table that we have selected once we, you know, connect it to a data source. And so we don't really have to use SQL. Everything else works the same. You know, we pick what our fields are. We set the display text. We set the value. And we're off to the races. We don't have to write SQL. And by the same token, the fill fields from DB does the exact same thing, except, of course, once again, ooh, that's not what I wanted to do. Let's try that one more time. Preview our custom config again. And again, I generally just choose my database and I select my where filter right from here. I generally don't have to write a SQL statement because my where filters are already filled up here with dropdowns, and I can use a form to provide the filter value that I want to look at. But again, it just pulls back ideally a single record, and I can take the columns in that record and I can assign them to form fields. So the difference between the normal field fields or field dropdown and the advanced field fields and field dropdowns are that in the advanced versions, I have to write the SQL myself, whereas in the normal versions, it's assumed that you don't need to know how to write that SQL. Same thing happens with the field dropdown object from business value. Unlike the advanced version, it doesn't require that I write SQL. I just grab the data from, in this case, that's field dropdown from business value. Okay, fine. In this case, I just grab a business value and fill the dropdown. I was actually looking for field dropdown object from DB. This is the one we want. So again, doesn't necessarily require that I have to write any SQL, although the advanced one does. So with the fill dropdowns, well, all of the fill custom tasks we've gone through. So here's another one of the rule query custom tasks. In this case, it's an advanced rule query from database. I'm going to have to write some SQL. I'm going to have to pull data from my SQL database. However, I can return that data now as a business rule value, just as we saw earlier with the other custom task, the other rule query custom task. Basically, this allows me to, in conjunction with a business value, I call the business value. The business value calls the custom task. The custom task run returns my data and sends it back to the business rule, and the business rule returns it as a business rule value. Let me check for questions again. None. Let's continue to move. The array SQL command. Now, if I have an array on the form, the array SQL command allows me to just actually write some SQL, pull some data back, and fill an array on the form. It's pretty simple. Again, deprecated. I can do this automatically simply by binding an array to a business value and just specify the business value properties and the columns in the array that get filled out. And it just happens automatically. So again, largely deprecated, don't have to use it. Business values serve that purpose as well. Clone table from DB is a new one. What it allows you to do, not with the process director database, but with your own database, either the user tables in the internal user database or tables from any accessible external database that you have, it will allow you to copy a table from one database and place that table in a different database along with all of the existing data. So if I have data in some external database that my organization uses, I could actually copy that table with all of its data, bring it into my internal user database in Process Director and just copy all of that data. Once again, cannot do that with any of the Process Director internal database tables, table projects, table project activity, table form data. None of those are accessible. You can't use it for any of that stuff. Okay, so we've done those three. Now, I should have done it in order, but it doesn't make logical sense to do them in order. Field in rule query from, okay, there is a rule query. We looked at the advanced rule query. The rule query from DB follows that same convention. I just generally don't have to write SQL necessarily, although, again, there is a text box to allow you to drop in a SQL where statement if you need it. But for the most part, you don't need to know SQL to do it. So anytime you see advanced, that generally means you have to write all of the SQL. If you don't see advanced, it means that you don't. SQL command is an important one, and it's still useful. Here's the thing about Process Director. If you drop any SQL inside any of these SQL command text boxes, we don't care what SQL you write. What Process Director is going to do is it's going to take whatever SQL you've written and it's going to send it off to the SQL server and it's going to run that data. And if you've written something destructive, like a delete command or whatever, that command is going to be run on SQL Server. That's true everywhere in the product. It's true in a business value. You can create a SQL business value that doesn't actually return data. Technically, you can create a SQL business value that just drops all the data in your, or drops all the tables in your database. You don't want to do that. So in all of these other custom tasks and in business values, if you want to use a select statement to return data or use a stored procedure to return data, you can do that all day long. Anytime that you're going to write an update, insert, or delete command, you need to use only the SQL command custom task to write that custom task or write that SQL command, transmit it to your server. Something else to be careful of. If I have everything connected up in this custom task, everything is configured properly, I've connected to my database, and I've decided to write a delete command, assuming I'm not using a bunch of parameters like form field system variables that would require, I actually have some parameters to pass, in which case, if those parameters don't exist, you know, nothing will happen because it won't find any matching records. But if I just write like delete star from my table, there is this button here that allows you to test the SQL command, the execute SQL command button. Be super careful about clicking that because it will transmit your SQL command to the database and it will attempt to run it. And if you have a valid delete command that deletes everything from a table, your SQL server is going to do that because Process Director does not vet. It does not validate. It does not verify. It does not warn you about the SQL commands that you write. Whatever SQL command that you've written, that's on you. And so when you click execute SQL command, or when this custom task runs, the thing you say here in this SQL command box that you want to happen, it's gonna happen. So anytime you have insert, delete, or update commands, that's when you use the SQL command custom task. That will never be deprecated by business values, even though all of these other fields, or these other custom tasks at this point are largely deprecated because, well, business values exist. Like the documents custom task. And here's one that, I can't imagine most of you care about. It is the convert to laserfish custom task. If this was 1967, this would probably be one of the most popular custom tasks we have, but it isn't, so it isn't. However, this will actually convert documents or whatever to laserfish references. So, and you can actually, you know, export an item in the content list to laserfish. If you're still using laserfish, well, good for you. It's good that we keep these analog technologies alive. Export array to CSV. This just takes the contents of an array and exports it to a CSV file. That's it. There's nothing more that we really need to talk about that. It's pretty simple. Fields from Excel, on the other hand, not quite as simple. Now, note, this is not going to work. Again, we are not running it from a form. So it's getting all higgledy-piggledy and afraid. It doesn't know what's going on. But when you run this in a form, what it allows you to do is to grab data from an Excel spreadsheet and fill form values in your form directly from the Excel spreadsheet. That spreadsheet can be in the content list. It can be as an attachment. Usually, we are going to fill an array on a form if it's Excel data. And that's generally what we expect because we expect there's going to be multiple rows in the Excel spreadsheet. We need to, if we're going to copy that data over, we're going to fill out multiple rows in the form itself, which generally requires that we use an array. This is the only time, it's the only custom task, and the only situation in which a document attachment can be used to provide data inside the form. This is the only time that documents are a data source for form fields. The attachment can't be used outside of the context of the specific, if it's an attachment, it can't be used outside the context of the instance to which it is attached. It can't be pulled from a data source, like from a file system data source or whatever. It either has to exist in a place in the content list, a fixed place in the content list, in which case we can grab it, you know, anytime we need it. But if it's attached to a form or a process timeline instance, it can only be used inside that instance. Other instances cannot use it as a data source. If you want to use it in separate instances, you're going to have to upload it separately to each of those instances. There's also a little wrinkle here in the mapping. You can, I don't remember exactly where it is. I may have to add the mapping, but you can actually specify the sheet in the data source. It's here, and I can't do it here because I can't actually configure anything in preview mode. But you can actually specify a sheet name. If your Excel spreadsheet has multiple worksheets inside it, you can actually specify a sheet name via a form control on the form, but we can't do any of that sort of mapping, so I can't demonstrate it. But you can specify that the data be taken from a specific Excel worksheet inside the Excel overall spreadsheet. So if there are five worksheets, you can specify one of the five to pull your data. Send a calendar invitation is a convenient one. And in fact, we have at least one customer I know of that uses this quite extensively because they're automating a lot of their conferencing stuff. And they're just relying on Process Director to assist them with this by sending calendar invitations. So we can actually set up a meeting inside Process Director, and Process Director will send out calendar invitations. All of the invitations that get sent out from this custom task are in ICS format. ICS is the sort of generally agreed upon format for calendar events across everybody, except kind of Microsoft. Microsoft has improved over the last couple of years their integration with ICS. For a while after we first created this, one of the problems was that Microsoft would look at an ICS file and go, "Oh, that's icky. Are you sure you want to bring in an ICS file? Because ICS file really sucks." And you'd have to go through this extra step or two to get Microsoft to accept the ICS file. Apparently, they've decided that they will, for once, comply with standards. And so if you now have the current version of Microsoft Outlook, it will simply accept the ICS calendar invitation as a valid invitation and not require you to separately import it into Exchange format before it can be placed on your calendar. So this allows you to set up meetings, recurring meetings, assign, you know, multiple users or groups or whatever you want to schedule a meeting with people. Transform form to word is another one about which I have a webinar. It's in fact the same webinar where I talk about the attach form custom task. This has to have a container form. We generally run it from a form. It can be run from a process timeline as long as you set a container form, but you must set a container form for this because it needs to know exactly where the data is coming from. And what it allows you to do is to pull data from a form field and to fill out a Word document and to insert form field data into a Word document. I used it as I have in the webinar where I discussed this, sort of a mail merge type of deal where I replace the addressee and a couple of fields inside the Word document itself. The thing is, inside Word, we have a special convention that lets Process Director know that a field is, in fact, it's not a form field. It's kind of a field marker. And what we do is we use the greater than and less than signs. Let me pop open Visual Studio Code real quick. I say real quick. There we go. And let's pull it over. And I need to just grab a new text file. So inside the Word document, using this convention, and this is literally just text in the Word document. There's nothing special. This has nothing to do with Word's built-in form controls or form features. This is literally just text that you put in between these markers. The two less than signs, field name, and then the two greater than signs. Process Director is going to look for that. And then it says, okay, that must be the name of a field in the form. And that's the end of the field. So I am going to replace this text, and it is literal text in the document. I'm going to replace this with whatever form field you have mapped to it. And so anytime that you want to put a field in a Word document, all you have to do is use that convention. Generally, the Word document is stored in the content list as a template, and this custom task just pulls that template document out and replaces these field names with actual Process Director form fields. And so the transform form to Word, which I think we thought it was open. Maybe I didn't preview the custom config on it, or I closed it. No, I did preview it. I must have closed it. But this is how you configure it. Basically, you just map. Once you have a content object and you specify, we're looking for the Word template, and you pick that Word template for this custom task, there's a refresh document fields button, and everything that is inside those greater than and less than signs will be read as a field. And it will appear in a dropdown down here so that you can just pick whatever, you know, field that is in the document. So it's pretty, pretty convenient custom task. Was that, that was documents. Okay. So now we're moving into form. And the first one is add JavaScript. Add JavaScript just enables you to throw some JavaScript into a form. Now, there is kind of a cool thing with this. You can just run, you know, any sort of generic JavaScript that you want inside the form. And if necessary, you can also use system variables in your JavaScript. Although, that's a little trickier. If you check this box, it allows you to type in system variables. Now, trouble with system variables is that they exist inside curly brackets. And the trouble with JavaScript is it uses curly brackets as well. And so you have to be sure that you, it's generally the last one, generally anytime you, after a system variable, where you might have normally a curly bracket in your JavaScript, you kind of got to double up on those curly brackets. It actually does change how the syntax of your JavaScript has got to work in order to be able to A, parse the system variable, but not parse your JavaScript as system variable. So it is a little tricky, but it can be done. In fact, I got a tech support ticket about this just about 2 weeks ago, where they had some JavaScript and it worked fine. And then they said, well, I'm just going to throw in a system variable in there. And they began to get concerned that their JavaScript began throwing syntax errors, and it threw syntax errors because of Process Director's basic attempt to always parse curly brackets as system variables. And in JavaScript, it's just JavaScript and it uses curly brackets normally. The show alert custom task. Now there's actually two of these. This is the advanced show alert. I have a webinar on this too, where I've used it. By the way, let me go ahead and close that out. I think we're done with that. This is a really full featured custom task. It was actually created by Sean Campbell at the City of Fort Worth, who created this custom task and sent it off to us. We loved it. So we threw it into the product because it's a pretty cool custom task. It allows you to highly customize the alert box that you show, change the type of message that you show. It will automatically click buttons on the form, so you can use it as a confirmation dialogue for a whole bunch of stuff. It's really super useful. You can actually throw in input fields into the dialogue box and then transfer the value that the user puts in that input fields to a field on the form. Super cool. It's a great custom task. Highly recommended because it gives you so much control over how the alert function works, and it just gives you a lot of extra possibilities. Now, there is a regular show alert, which is way down here. It is way less customizable. And once again, I've done the wrong thing. So let's pull that back up and try her again. It's way less customizable. It allows you to set the caption, the text, and change the alert icon. And that's about it. You can configure it and test it just right here. There we go. That's what a success alert looks like. That's it. So sometimes this is great. I mean, it is certainly way more lightweight, the show alert custom task. And if all you need to do is just show an alert and you don't have any, you know, frills that you want to put on it, that's fine. But the advanced show alert really does give you, a lot of extra options. The fill dropdown from form data basically allows you to take items that are in an array, usually, to take items that are in an array and fill a dropdown from them. So this was actually something that was specifically customer requested, because they had a form where they had this array and they were putting in all these items in an array. And then later on in the process, they wanted somebody to just pick one of those items from a dropdown during the approval process. And there was no way to do it. Well, now there's this custom task, and there is a way to do that. So you can just specify an array and an array column and because it's a dropdown, you can actually specify two columns, one for text, display text, and one for the value of the dropdown. And as you fill out the array on the form, and you call this custom task, it will fill out the dropdown at the bottom of the form. So this is great. Of course, depending on how quickly you need that dropdown to be filled, you may have to call this custom task a lot, like every time a new row is added, what have you, any form on the display event, perhaps, where you might want to call this custom task so that every time there's a change to the array and the display event fires, the dropdown is filled with the appropriate values. But it's a real convenient custom task for that. And the customer was quite happy with it. The form save custom task, not much to talk about here. It saves the form. You do have a configuration option. It's one that we just added back in August. There's not a checkbox where you can close the form after saving. Prior to August, there was no configuration option at all. This was the custom task. It saves the form. That's what it does. There's no reason to get into much more detail about that. Get geolocation actually pulls form latitude and longitude data from a browser. Generally, we would use this in terms of mobile devices. So if I have an iPad or an iPhone or a Galaxy tablet or a Samsung phone, what have you, in both cases, whether it's Apple or Android, GPS is generally live on those phones, so we know where you are. So enjoy carrying around your government-approved tracking device every day, just like I do. The nice thing about having your tracking device on you at all times is that I can pull geographic location from you. We actually had a municipal customer that requested this because they send out code inspectors all of the time. And obviously, when you're just out roaming the streets of the city, you don't have connection to the network. And so what they wanted to be able to do was just have a form that was just available publicly on the internet that their inspectors out in the field could access. They could open that form and then just get geolocation so that when they were taking pictures of, let's say, properties with code violations or during inspections or what have you, they could tag those pictures or tag that form submission with the actual geolocation of where the inspector was, what property they were looking at. And so all you really have to do is just have a container form and specify the field that will store your latitude and longitude, and your phone or tablet's browser will just pass that latitude and longitude data straight to the process director form to allow you to geolocate where you are. Sort of in conjunction with that, there is another geolocation one that shows a map on a form. Now, it's not quite the same, but if you use it in conjunction with the get geolocation and you fill out an array on the form with latitude and longitude based on all of these different locations that you went to, you can actually generate a map on a form. And if you're using an array field, it will actually not only show you the appropriate map for that form, it's a Google map, by the way, not only show you the appropriate Google map for that form, but all of those latitude and longitudes that you have saved, if you have it on an array, will show up as the little markers, you know, those little, they're not really teardrops, or if they are, they're upside down teardrops that Google uses as markers. And you can display all of those markers on the map. So you can basically kind of, you know, get a route of where the user was. Again, this was a municipal customer who were using it for code inspectors out in the field. So the get geolocation and the show map on form kind of work hand in hand. Mobile form import. I know one of you that's here right now uses this. I don't think anybody else does, because this is specific to the BP Logic's mobile application component, which allows, you know, offline, you know, filling out and submitting of forms, and then when you get back into the network, you can import that that data out of the app. If you don't have that additional component, this custom task is not useful to you in any way, shape, or form. But what it's designed to do is, if I'm out in the field, and even if I have no internet access at all, if I have the BP Logix mobile app, I have a copy of the forms that I need. And I can open up the forms that I need, and I can fill them out, and I can, you know, quote unquote, submit them. I'm not really submitting them. They're just being saved on my device. At some point in the fullness of time, I'm going to be back where I have internet access. And once I have appropriate internet access, those local forms that I have saved on my device will now just be synced with the BP Logix mobile app server. And they'll remain stored on that mobile app server until they're imported into Process Director. So this is a custom task that you generally run on a recurring basis, whatever scheduled basis you like, to actually go out to the mobile server and grab all of the form submissions that it has gathered since the last import, and it will import all of that form data back into Process Director and create the appropriate form and process instances inside Process Director to match those forms that were generated out in the field. Again, it's a separately licensed component. And of the people who are here in this webinar, only one of you has it. So for the rest of you, it's just not something you'll use. It's just you're not licensed for it. We're gonna show my form, I guess, finally. Random code generator does exactly what it says. It generates a random code. You can then take that random code and place it into a form field. You specify the pattern basically using regular expressions, or at least a subset of regular expressions. This is what we allow you to use. And so you just create the pattern that you want using these regular expression symbols, and it just creates a random code based on that pattern and then places that code into a form. Again, Sean Campbell, City of Fort Worth, is the one who created this custom task. Set focus custom task. Well, you're all going to want to use this one because anytime that you have a form field that is an event field, when the event fires, the form is going to reload. When the form reloads, it resets your tab order and places your cursor all the way back up to the top of the form in field one. That is super inconvenient. So if I'm way down at the bottom of the form trying to fill it out and I fill out an event field, my form is going to reload. Now, it's not going to look any different to me as an end user, except for the fact that my cursor will have disappeared because it's moved all the way up to the very top of the form again. That's super inconvenient because now I've got to take my mouse, I've got to click in the next field right next to the one I just filled out. You don't want users to do that. You want tab order to work the way it is supposed to work. So if I fill out an event field and I hit my tab key, when that form reloads, I need to specify where I want my cursor to go next, which is usually in the field right next to the one that I just filled out, right to the immediate right of it. And so what the set focus custom task does is it allows you to specify the field that you want to have the cursor show up in after the form field event fires. And so if you have five event fields on the form, you might need five set focus custom tasks running so that as people tab their way, and that's what most data entry people do, right? They type in their data, they hit the tab key, and they just expect the cursor to move to the next field. If it's an event field, that doesn't happen, and they have to keep hitting the tab key 30 times to get the cursor back to where they want it. And the set focus just fixes that by sticking the cursor in precisely the field where you want it to show. We looked at show alert earlier. We looked at show map on form earlier. So let's get to validate form. Most of the time, whenever you fill out a form, validation of the data that you've put in that form does not occur until you hit the submit button. Only once you hit the submit button does the form validate, and if it validates properly, the form gets submitted. If it doesn't validate properly, you get a warning message. That's great, except sometimes you have real complicated forms. And what you don't want to do when the user hits the OK button to submit the form is to have 30,000 validation errors show up. The user is not going to remember all of those errors. It's just not helpful. Validation errors when a form is submitted are super useful if there's like one or two things that I didn't do. If there's 5 or 8 or 10 things that I didn't do, those validation error messages are useless to me. I'm not going to sit, memorize those 10 items and go back and fix it. The way to avoid that problem is just to call form validation at other times. So what this custom task allows you to do is just validate the form on any desired event. So for example, I can make a field an event field, and it might be an important field that I need to have specific data in. So because it's an event field, I can just run validate form right then and there. And if there is a validation error on that form field, I can catch it immediately while they're still filling out that form. So validate form is pretty useful, especially on complex forms that may require a lot of validation. Rather than saving up all of the validation errors to the end, you may want to prompt validation a couple of times while they're filling out the form so that as they're filling it out, they can catch those validation errors in a timely manner and not try to fix them all at the very end. This does not conflict in any way with normal form validation. When you hit the submit button, normal form validation is still going to fire, and this is just an extra iteration of form validation that you can run anytime you would like. Similarly, there is validate form field, which allows you to take a single form field and validate it according to a regular expression. So it has to match the pattern of some regular expression. If it doesn't match, then you can provide the appropriate error message. This is a very, very specific type of validation. And basically, it's for validating when you require a specific format to your data, and you want to catch it to be sure that the user has put in that specific format before they move on to the next field. And so using regex, it allows you to do that. It's 11:13 and we're behind time. However, there's a lot of these custom tasks we don't even have to discuss. So doesn't look as bad as it seems just looking at the content list. I am a lot farther along, I think, than it looks. Convert number to text. This literally takes a number and returns the English language number. So I can take in a numeral 1 and it will return the text O-N-E. And if I type in 51, it will return 51. If you want to include the dash character in 51, you can turn it off, but it's a pretty simple custom task. It actually takes a numerical value and then converts it into whatever the English text is. I guess that would be great if you're writing a check, right? Where you could just type in 110 and then in the long text thing, it would just show 110. All right. Why didn't it select copy form data? All right, copy form data, it just takes data from one form and copies it to another form. Well, it's actually a little bit more than that. It actually creates a new instance of a form and copies all of the data from whatever the current form is to that new form. Note I said it creates a new instance of the form. Does not copy data between two existing instances of a form. Copy form data always creates a new form instance and then copies data to that new form instance. It will not copy data between two existing form instances. I have a training webinar where I cover this in some detail. So for more details, please look at that webinar. Okay, Phil Fields from Business Value. This is one of those weird ones that I'm not entirely sure when you would need to use it, largely because we have the Phil Fields tab on forms now, but way back in 4.2 and 4.3, we had the business value, but we didn't really have a way of getting business value data into the form, so we created this custom task. So this has largely been deprecated because Phil Fields and Phil Dropdowns tabs now exist on forms. So I can't imagine why you would need to call this, but for that brief period between, you know, version 4.3 and 4.5, we needed a custom task that did that. This was the custom task that did that. I'm pretty sure that there are not too many use cases where you still need to use it. On the other hand, manipulate array data is fantastically useful in some cases because what it allows you to do is to sort an array or to copy data from, you know, one array to another. So I can copy data between arrays. It allows me to remove data from arrays. It allows me to copy normal non-array field data to an array. So for example, I might have an array that has five columns. I need to get data into that column. But what I don't want to do is force my user to scroll through this array to get to the very bottom of it to enter the data. I might just want to have five fields at the top of my form. And the user can just fill out those five fields. When they're done, click a button that says add this data. And then I can just take those five fields and add them to the five columns of the array. So that, along with being able to copy arrays, being able to resort arrays and all that, it's a pretty cool custom task if I'm dealing with arrays. So keep it in mind. Set form data custom task. Again, one of those that is largely deprecated by the existence of business values because you have, and by the existence of the set form data tab in the form definition. So most of the things that you would use or would have used this custom task for in the past are simply no longer necessary. They're just built into the form directly. However, there are a couple of times when this is useful. For those of you who've watched my webinars, you know that whenever I create the request number, the unique request number that I assign to every request, I always have a process timeline activity that simply calls the set form custom task or set form data custom task. And it actually creates my sequence number in the appropriate format that I want. And then it saves that to the form. Even though technically inside the process timeline itself, there is a set form data section where I could actually just do that automatically in the process timeline. I still use this custom task for that specifically because it makes it obvious what I'm doing so that someone who comes after me and sees what I'm doing will use it. But that's a pretty isolated use case anymore. That is one of the only times I think I really use it for that. It remains fantastically useful. For everything else, both forms and process timelines already have set form data built into them as part of their core functionality. So that is largely deprecated. All right, the IoT custom tasks. I don't even know why we're talking about them. None of you have it. There's only one IoT custom task. And what it allows you to do is send a message to a Microsoft Azure Internet of Things device. And so you can specify the device ID, specify the message you want to send, and you can send it to your IoT device. So, you know, for everybody that's got a Microsoft Azure refrigerator, you knock yourself out. You send as many messages as you want. Outside of manufacturing, I just can't imagine anybody who has the need to send Azure IoT messages, but it exists and it's part of the, it's just part of the, I think we built it at the same time we built the machine learning object so that we could actually, you know, send messages to devices based on production information. Copy metadata. So this allows me to take metadata from one object and copy it to another object. You don't need to use this one much, not copy metadata, because for the most part, metadata is inherited whenever objects are created from their parent. And so therefore, you know, if I upload a document attachment to a form instance, well, the form instance, if it has metadata assigned, most likely got that metadata assigned from the parent form definition. And when I create that document attachment and I upload it to the form, that document attachment will just automatically inherit the metadata attributes and categories that were assigned to the form instance when it was created. So inheritance is great. It works fine. But sometimes you may want to copy metadata to another object, especially if you change metadata. So it's possible for me to open up a form. It has its own metadata. Great. Then I upload a document. Great. It inherits the metadata. Now I go into the form and I change the form's metadata. I add new categories or change the value of attributes. Okay, great. But my document has all of the metadata that existed when I created the attachment by uploading it. Now the parent object has different metadata than the child object. Well, in that case, I'm probably going to want to copy that metadata to the child object. There's also a set metadata custom task. I have an entire training webinar on metadata where I cover the use of this custom task. This is an important custom task, especially on a form where I have a category picker and an attribute picker. You would think incorrectly that if I have a category and an attribute picker on a form, and I pick a category, that the form just automatically inherits that category. That is not true. The category and the attribute pickers are just data. So, if I open up that form and I've chosen a category, that category will be displayed in the form field, but all I'm doing is displaying the category in a form field. I have not applied that metadata to the form. That's intentional, by the way, because I might not want to apply that metadata to the form automatically. I need to be able to choose specifically what metadata goes where. So I do need the set metadata custom task, which will work in conjunction with the category selector or the attribute selector to apply that metadata to other objects. And of course, I can specify which of the objects to which I want to apply that metadata. So even very simply, even if I did want to apply that metadata to the form itself, so I go in and I change the category or I add new categories to the category picker. That's all well and good. But if I want to apply that metadata to that form, then I need to run the set metadata custom task to actually apply the metadata. So when you're dealing with metadata, this is a custom task that you're probably going to need to be familiar with, especially in terms of if you're using a form to like build a document library or something like that, and you are assigning metadata categories on the fly, which is the most common use case for building libraries like that, then you are going to need to have some category pickers on a form, maybe some attribute pickers on a form, and you are going to have to set that metadata on the fly while you're filling out that form. Okay, there are three types of custom tasks which you may or may not have on your installation. that we need to get out of the way. There's the MS Dynamics custom tasks. If you have them, the OData custom tasks, and whether you have them or not depends on when was the first time you uploaded custom tasks to your system. Some of you may not have them at all. Some of you may have them. Then there are the Salesforce custom tasks. So Salesforce, OData, and Microsoft Dynamics used to all work in the product. And then a company called CData acquired the licensing for all three of these products. So MS Dynamics, OData, and SharePoint. And so now you can't use Process Director anymore to talk to SharePoint or to MS Dynamics, to Salesforce, or to any OData data source, unless you go and obtain a license from CData. And that has nothing to do with BP Logix, nothing to do with Process Director. Back in the old days, if you were a developer, any product that you created was covered under your license for those connectors. CData decided that that was not making them enough money. And so now every instance that uses their connectors has to be licensed directly from CData. So that means you're going to need to go get the license for these custom tasks to run, or these connectors. And then you're going to have to either install it on your server if you're on-premise, or give us the licensing files if you're a cloud customer so that we can implement them on your particular instance. But you have to find them and buy them on CData's website and then provide them to us after you've purchased them. Generally, there are only two custom tasks for each of these three areas. There is the fill dropdowns and the fill fields custom tasks. So I can fill dropdowns from Dynamics, OData, or Salesforce, or I can fill fields from either of those three. They're all super simple. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on them because most of you don't have these licenses. So it works very similar to the fill fields from database or fill dropdowns from database. The only difference is the data source you're using is either an OData database, Microsoft Dynamics, or Salesforce, but those are all database-based systems. And so you're just touching their database. And really, they're all OData databases, I think, for the most part. And so it's very similar to fill dropdowns and fill fields from DB because they are essentially the same custom task and do exactly the same thing. And the configuration screens look exactly the same. But if you don't have the license for them, you can't use them. And if you don't have the license for them and you want to get rid of them, you know, feel free, you can. But I think I don't think we include OData anymore, but I think we still include MS Dynamics and Salesforce because we do have customers that use them. So they're still in the package. I think many of you might not have the OData custom tasks in there. And if you don't, no real reason to worry about it, I don't guess. All right, convert to PDF. So now we are in our PDF custom tasks. And all this does is convert a form or document attachments to PDF, or a form and document attachments. It's got a couple little wrinkles to it. And again, I have a webinar that covers how to use this thing in way more detail. You can convert your form and document attachments to PDF as separate files, or you can convert them as one big merged file. And if you output them as a single merged file, you can control the order in which they appear. You can make all of the forms appear first and then all of the documents appear later. And over and above that, in those two different sections, you can sort them alphabetically or by creation date or update date or when it was attached, so that you can end up with this nicely grouped and sorted PDF file that contains everything. And this, by the way, is used often and associated with the laser fish thing, right? Because what you would do is you would take your, and let's say you want to archive your processes. Right, it's been 10 years since you've had Process Director. You've got millions of processes. You might want to archive some of the older ones, right? So you can just run the convert to PDF. It'll just create these PDF files, and then you can run the convert to LaserFish, and you can just convert all of the PDF files to LaserFish so that someone can go back and use your LaserFish system 30 years from now to look at your old files. I think actually very few people convert anything to LaserFish. Somebody did used to, by the way. I know as recently as 2016, somebody was still doing that. I think today most people just create those PDFs and they simply save them. They just simply export them to a file location. And so there's some, you know, shared folder somewhere that that stores all of those old archived processes. Okay, this custom task has to be used inside a form, or it must have a container form set if you use it in a process timeline, or it doesn't work. This is to fill fields from PDF. If you have a fillable PDF form that someone has submitted to you, you can actually take that PDF form, extract the data from the fillable form fields in the PDF, and stick them onto a process director form. So someone fills out a PDF form and then opens up your form, uploads that PDF form as an attachment. You can just grab that attachment, pull the data out of the PDF form, and just import it into process director. Super convenient, especially if people are, you know, submitting your state or federal government forms. PDF rendition of documents. This is a weird one, and I think is largely deprecated, if not completely deprecated. In fact, I'm not even sure all of you have this custom task. I do, because I've been around for a while. As you can see, the last time we updated this custom task was October 25th of 2011. The convert to PDF custom task completely eliminates your need for running this custom task. All it does is convert document attachments to PDF. Doesn't even convert the form. You have convert to PDF. That's the one you want to use. PDF annotation merge. Again, this is only relevant. Come on. Just open the thing for me, please. The PDF annotation merge is only relevant to those who have the separately licensed component for collaborative document markup and collaborative document authoring. In this case, specifically collaborative document markup, because what it will allow you to do is to merge all of the annotations from various users that are collected during the markup process, merge them into a single PDF, and then attach that PDF to the form or the process. Again, separately licensed component. If you don't have CDM/CDA, that custom task is largely useless to you. Signed PDF. Now, this is kind of a cool one because what it allows you to do is, and it says sign PDF, and it says it allows you to superimpose a signature on a PDF document. It's not exactly true. That's what it's largely used for, but actually you can superimpose any image you want on a PDF document. If you're like me, I've got a little folder on my system where I actually have some electronic signatures that are my actual signature. One is just my scrawled Dale. One is my weird little DF initials, and one is my actual signature. They're all PNG files. And if I needed to sign with an actual signature-y signature, I could certainly do that by using that signature image. but the image just happens to be a signature. It could be any image, but it sticks it onto a PDF. This is a super tedious custom task to configure, because we don't actually know where that signature is supposed to appear on the PDF. So you have to mark the location of the top and, well, the top of the image and the left of the image. So it's the distance from the top of the PDF or the distance from the left side of the PDF. And is it in pixels? No, it is not. Those measurements are in points, not pixels. So apparently it's 1964 again, and we're using points for measurements on document, like we're using a typewriter, for goodness sakes. And then you also have to set the height and width of the doc of the image in points. And you are never going to know how many points you are from the top. Nobody has any. I remember there used to be rulers that were actually measured in points. And you could actually, when you were doing layout, you could actually measure how many points away from the things other things were. Nobody has those rulers anymore because nobody does that. Nobody measures in points anymore. Except, of course, for Adobe. And so we have to do everything in points, which means you're going to have to reconfigure this about 30 times to get your signature image where you want it in the right size to fit inside the box on the PDF file. Once you have it done, it's super useful, but the configuration process is worse than being stabbed. Transform form to PDF. Now, we had the transform form to Word that we saw earlier this webinar, where you have the little greater than and less than signs, and you put text in between them, and that's magically a field in Microsoft Word. Fillable PDF forms, on the other hand, have actual fields, and we know what those fields are, and we know what they're named, and we can take data from a Process Director form, and we can fill a fillable PDF by just transferring that data from the Process Director form fields to the Adobe PDF form fields. Super simple. Again, it does require a container form for this task, as you can see from the error message. So you must set the container form if you're using it in a process timeline. If I haven't made it clear, if you run this as a form custom task, Process Director obviously assumes that the form we're currently working in is the container form, and we don't have to set that. But in a process timeline, it's not that obvious, so we have to set the container form. But again, just transfers data from Process Director's form fields to a fillable PDF form field. So now we're into the process custom tasks. So the first one is change activity due date. So you can specify a process timeline activity, and you need the activity instance ID, or this is not going to work. But if you have the proper activity instance ID, you can change the duration and or due date of that specified activity instance. Assuming it's running in the current process, you should be able to retrieve the activity instance ID pretty easily, especially if you're in the actual running activity, by doing something like that and setting in the, well, I didn't mean to bring in the ticks. Copied it from Markdown, so it adds ticks in with the text. But I can just pull activity running name, right? And just pull format equals ID, and it will actually pull the activity instance ID. So if I was running this in the current running activity, I could just automatically grab the activity instance and then change its due date or its duration. So the activity instance ID will accept system variables. And so assuming that you can pull the ID for, you know, the activity instance name, and you can always format it as ID, and you can always grab that via system variable. Email action. This is after you do the import email that we talked about earlier when you're doing offline completion via email and somebody sends an email in. When I import that email, I've got to run the email import custom task as part of a special import process to bring in all those emails into Process Director and to attach them to the appropriate processes. Once they're attached to the appropriate process, I do need to run the email action custom task because this is the custom task that actually looks at the email, parses the text, and determines whether I have approved or disapproved the task. Generally, and I have an entire webinar on this, as I mentioned earlier, but generally we can pull the results and any comments or any other mapping that we might want to add to the email. We can also set up a message that we send to the user if their email attempt failed to approve or disapprove the task that's assigned to them, we could send them a message on success as well. As I said earlier, I have an entire webinar on this where I cover the use of both of those custom tasks in far, far greater detail. Jump to step custom task only works inside the workflow object itself. So it can only be invoked from a workflow object. You should no longer be creating things with the workflow object. So this custom task should largely be unnecessary to you. However, I do know some of you do still use workflows here and there, or perhaps with older things that you did back in the dim mists of time. And what this will allow you to do is jump from a current step to any step that you specify. Caution, all intervening steps, if any, will be skipped completely. It will go from step one to step 56, if that's what you specify it to do, and the intervening 55 steps will be ignored. So if you're still using workflows, stop. And if you want to do a jump to step in a workflow, exercise appropriate caution. Manage task users. Can't imagine why you would show this to end users. This is largely for administrative users. Although it is occasionally useful to stick one of these on a form, but to hide, to run it on a form, but to only allow administrators to access it so that they could add or cancel or reassign users in the task. Now, I say administrators. It could also be process administrators. There is also as we talked about last week, a manage task users control on the form that you can also use to add, cancel, or reassign users in a task. So it might not be system administrators that you might want to run this. You might want to give a little button on the form that is hidden to everyone but people who are designated as process administrators, maybe people in a process administrators group, which would enable them to open up the form and manage the process users from the form just automatically. There are some other times where depending on what happens in a process, you might just want to run this custom task as part of your process timeline. Let's say that something didn't get done or some other thing happened or some data somewhere is in some specified state. And because of that, you might want to add users or cancel the current user or reassign the task to a completely different user. So this is still useful in the context of a process timeline whenever you expect perhaps weird things to happen that require you to change the users who are assigned to a task. I mean, it's still useful in that context. And of course, because it's encapsulated in that case inside the process timeline itself, end users don't have access to it. But we would expect that you would have some sort of set in stone programmatic plan for who gets added or who gets canceled or, you know, how that reassignment works. And there are also error messages that can pop up for both success or for the various types of failure that you might encounter. The post custom task, and it's actually called post to instance. The post to instance custom task allows you to select a process instance ID. Again, system variables are allowed, and to post a string to that particular instance. Essentially, if I have a wait task, I can set a wait task up and I can say, wait until some value exists. And I can actually post that value to the waiting custom task. So it will wake the process and complete the wait activity that I have running there. Now, of course, I have to have a condition specified to end the wait activity. Whatever message I put in the post string has to match the expected message in that condition. But assuming that that is true, then it will just wake the waiting activity and will allow it to run. Run PowerShell command. For the vast majority of you, no. I'm not even sure you have this in your system, but you might, because it is useful for on-premise customers. If you're a cloud customer, this is utterly irrelevant to you. If you're an on-premise customer, you can call a PowerShell script to run from Process Director to do, you know, either to run a batch file, run a PowerShell command, whatever you would like, you can do that. It actually runs any of the script files, PowerShell or bat files, and you can run them. If you are not an on-premise customer, you can't do this, so this custom task is simply not relevant to you. The run process custom task enables you to invoke another process as a sub-process, or if you would like, as a separate process from your current process. The process that you invoke will run asynchronously, which is to say your current process will not pause. I have an entire webinar on the use of this, as well as the use of the process custom or the process activity type in a process timeline for invoking synchronous and asynchronous sub-processes. The run process custom task always invokes a new process and it invokes it asynchronously. Run process from BV results. What this one allows you to do is to run a business value and then to run a process against that business value. There are various places in Process Director where I might want to run a whole bunch of processes at once. So on a form, I can actually take an array field and I can run a process for each row in an array. In a knowledge view, when I return knowledge view data, I can run a process for each row in a knowledge view. With this custom task, I can do the same thing with a business value. I can invoke a business value, and then I can run a process for each row in the business value. Now, is this a deprecated custom task? Kinda, yeah. Not sure why I would run this custom task now that the stream actions object exists. Because now that the stream actions object exists, I can not only invoke a process for each row in the business value, I can actually create and submit the form, and I can pull all of the data from the business value and stick it in the form and submit the form, invoke my process, and I'm off to the races. So I can actually use a business value as a data stream, use it in a stream action, and I can kick off all the processes I want. So this still exists. We haven't updated it since 2018, as you can see. It's still there on the product. But I think that in this case, pretty much everything that this does, I can accomplish with the stream action, and I think accomplish it a lot more efficiently. Plus, I can call the stream action on a scheduled basis, which I can't do with this. I mean, well, I guess I could, I guess. Back in the day, I would have used the scheduler utility and prompted this to run. I don't have to do that anymore. But it still exists. It's in the product. Most of you probably still have that. And in fact, there is the schedule processes. This one allows me to go through, back in oldie days, before the goal existed, or before the stream actions object existed, if we wanted to prompt things on a scheduled basis, there's a little scheduler utility kind of thing built into Process Director. There's actually a little scheduler form, and there's controls that you could put on it to specify the schedule you wanted to schedule in which you wanted something to run, and you could invoke things from it. And the purpose of this custom task was to go through all of those scheduling forms that you had on your system, iterate through them, and then start all of the processes that were defined by those instances. We haven't updated this since 2014. Goals and stream actions exist. Not sure why you would ever use this, because I doubt that anybody has any scheduler forms left in the system. If you want to know more about scheduler forms for historical purposes, I invite you to look in the documentation. Salesforce custom tasks, obviously we can safely skip those. By the way, the social media custom tasks, we can safely skip those as well. I've removed them from the documentation. You might as well remove them from the product as well, because none of these work because they've all changed how you access them. We're rebuilding these, so presumably they will come back at some point in the future, but for now, there are no social media custom tasks. SharePoint custom tasks. They basically all do the same thing. They grab data from SharePoint lists. There is the fill dropdown from SharePoint and fill dropdown object from SharePoint and fill fields from SharePoint. They are largely exactly the same as the custom tasks we have looked at previously. The only difference is that SharePoint is the data source, not SQL or whatever. Now, there is one thing about these, however, that we might want to look at. Oh, I see there's a question, so I'll have to get to that. Let me go to filter right there. For these three custom tasks, there is a filter, and this filter expects CAML data to be put in there. So if you don't know how to write the where node of a CAML query, CAML is the language that Microsoft uses for SharePoint. It's their data language. I don't know why they use it, but they do. I don't like that language, but SharePoint people should know it. And all of those three have the same feature of that filter, which uses CAML. Question. What is the best way to submit a recommendation to you for a webinar topic? Email me. dale.franks@bplogix.com. Worst comes to worst, and you can't figure out what my email is, you can go to the documentation website. At the bottom of every page, there is a documentation feedback form. I get every one of those that gets submitted. So If Dale at bplogix.com doesn't work for you, or Dale.franks at bplogix.com doesn't work for you, you can submit a webinar topic suggestion via the documentation feedback form, I guess, because I'll still see it. The important things in SharePoint are not the fill X from SharePoint, but the actual add to SharePoint list, because what this enables you to do is take a process director form, take the data and import that data into a SharePoint list so that you can actually create a SharePoint list out of process director form data. Also, you have the ability to both get files from SharePoint and push files to SharePoint. So for the get files from SharePoint and push file to SharePoint, you can take a, well, for get files, it enables you to grab files off of SharePoint, attach them to an object, and optionally, if you wanted to, set metadata for that object. So you can grab files out of SharePoint and stick them into your process as a process attachment. On the other end of that, you have push files to SharePoint, which allows you to take those SharePoint files and, or take those document attachments and push them to SharePoint so you can store them in a SharePoint folder or a SharePoint list. You can do one or the other, folder or list, but you can get that document attachment into SharePoint as part of that folder or list. Social media, as I said, those are dead. Don't have to worry about those. User, there's only two users. One is import users and one is provision users. Import users allows you to import users into Process Director. You can put a file in the content list that has all of your users in there, and you can just import that file. Generally, the way that you do it is you have a folder in your content list that automatically invokes a process when a new item is imported into it. You import your list of users in Excel, and it just invokes a process that calls the import users custom task, takes that Excel file, just imports all the users it contains into Process Director. Provision users is a little different because what that allows you to do is actually create the users manually using a Process Director form. It is not going to show up here in preview mode. This is one that is going to break, sorry. So I'm not going to show it to you. I'd have to show it to you in a form, but essentially it allows you to map form fields to Process Director user fields and then bring in and then create a new user account using a form rather than having to do it inside of Process Director. Oh, I am going to run out of time. I was not able to completely finish. So we're going to have to run through these real fast. In fact, not even going to show them to you. Form recognizer from REST, forget about it. If you don't have the VAX app that we sell separately, you don't need the form recognizer. It reads vaccination cards. The Prism HR user query. Do you work for Prism HR? No. So you don't need the Prism HR user query. A couple of these are just utilities. So there is the fill dropdown from REST web service, fill fields from REST, fill fields from web service. All of those exactly the same as we've been looking at. Those are our fill fields custom task. In this case, we're just using either REST or web service. Azure SMS. If you have Azure SMS and you can send SMS text messages, this custom task will allow you to use your Azure system to send SMS text messages to your users. Fill fields from payment gateway. If you are a Bank of America, what do they call it? Bank of America PCG integrated web payments. You can actually do e-commerce using that Bank of America payment gateway. It's really complex to fill out. You have to look at the documentation on that, but it allows you to actually accept payments via Process Director as long as you're part of that Bank of America deal. Finally, find text on web page. You tell it to look at a web page, In fact, we can look at this, and this is the last one we're going to look at. But you can tell it to go to this webpage. Here's the URL. I want you to find some text on that webpage, and then I want you to return the matches back to me. So you can actually search for a specified string on any webpage, and it will return the number of times that it found that search on a webpage. That can only be used as a form custom task and no other type. All right, that's it. It is, the ding just happened. It's noon. I'm done. We all have to go. See you next week. So long.